And though I still have not quite achieved that yet, one of the things I tried to do was to go back through all the magical systems which I had not hitherto explored, and to find a missing ingredient, a missing link in what it remains to be out there, to see if perhaps that I had overlooked something crucial. And what I basically not experimented with were things like crystals and astrology, because they struck me at the time as being kind of ridiculous and cheesy, and especially within terms of astrology, incredibly boring and dry. And just like it is always the last place in your closet that you find the missing sock, it's the discovery of astrological magic as it was implemented from about 500 BC to 1700 AD, where I feel I've met my magical maturity and has really completed my spiritual and methodological practice. And I want to teach it to you today, because one of the metaphors we see in astrological magic is reflection, in that the sun sheds light to the other planets, which in turn reflect downward to the earth. And so the knowledge that I've received, I feel obliged to reflect and refract down onto you, and hopefully you will be enriched by it, just like the sun makes the plants grow. Now, one of the things that I find frustrating in introductory material on magic is that they don't answer in a concrete way two crucial questions. What is magic, and where does it come from? Now, some systems have different ways of approaching that and do provide that answer. If you are familiar with Thelema, they will say that magic is true will. Any act of true will fulfill the conditions of magic. But different magical systems have different approaches and different answers to these questions. And what I'm going to be covering today will have a very different sort of answers and to these questions. What I'll be discussing is magic unlike anything you've ever heard before, most likely. And what's ironic about that is that it is where the term magic comes from. Now, there have been magical traditions coming from every part of history, in every land. Everybody seeks to engage in spiritual practice in one form or another, and usually there's a practical end to it too, which is why what we call magic is slightly distinctive from, say, Zen Buddhist practice, which is for enlightenment but doesn't always have a result such as getting you money, getting you laid, and killing your enemies, or whatever else you might be interested in. But originally, the term magic was a very narrow reference to a particular group of people. And these were what now, in formal historical and archaeological circles, referred to as the Magians. And they were a group of Persians who were a part of the sect of Zoroastrians. And the Zoroastrians were the first religious group which had something akin to monotheism, though technically you could say it's duotheistic or polytheistic. Now, they believed that there were two divinities, Ahura Mazda, the god of light, and Ahriman, his twin brother of darkness, and the world that we lived in was the battlefield in which they contested for dominion. But there was a sect of Zoroastrians who worshipped a theoretical god who created them all, the father to the twin gods of light and darkness, whom they called Zervan, the ultimate progenitor, and he was a god of time. And they believed that the ultimate worship would be go beyond this duality and reach into the powers of Zervan and bring them down into this world and complete their spiritual ascent. A small set of these Zervanites, these Zervanite heretics, were a caste called the Magians, and they practiced fire worship and a variety of other unusual techniques. But one thing that gives us a clue to who they were and what they did is that a few hundred years later, when the religious language of the Zoroastrians became Middle Persian, is that the word for Magian, for magician, became translated as the Adorned Ones. And this is when I believe they began inventing what we now call talismans. Talismans, as developed in the astrological magical tradition, are very unusual, and they're not like the sort of things you're going to be buying at most magic shops. They're not magical bling. Last year I said that there are basically three categories in my mind between charms, amulets, and talismans. Some of you may remember that. I say charms are, and this is some of this is my own terminology, charms are symbolic representations of a higher power. And for some people that's a crucifix, and some for people that's a pentagram. And it can be any number of things, but the power of a charm comes from the symbology within it. It can be charged, it may be given power, but it has no inherent virtue other than its symbology. The second category I use are amulets. These are objects which have natural properties that draw things to you or push things away from you. So that once upon a time, I would wear under my shirt a lapis lazuli necklace, which would make me calm and tranquil, because that's one of the things it does. And sometimes I would wear a malachite necklace to get me laid. if you're familiar with the hoodoo tradition, mojo bags also qualify as amulets. And its source of power is the natural vitality and the spirit of these elements which go within it, and the number and the symbology as well. So in this instance, amulets can also be charms, but the natural virtues of the substances which are applied within it are the primary source of power. Talismans are different. The word talisman first appears in a grimoire which was written around 800 AD, and it's a distortion of the Arabic word to break or to violate. The grimoire is the Bacatrix, which for a while was the most notorious book of black magic in history. So notorious that if you had a copy after a certain date, you would be burned at the stake for that alone, even if you couldn't read the book. It was translated into Latin around 1000 AD, and it was distributed throughout the West and became a very strong and important influence upon the Western Hermetic tradition. Recently, there's been a revival in interest in this traditional astrological magic, and two friends of mine have been forefronts of it. John Michael Greer, who recently retranslated the Bacatrix from the Latin version into English, and my friend Christopher Warnock, who runs renaissanceastrology.com. And if you are looking for resources beyond what I will be discussing today, you can certainly join my mailing list, which I hope you will all sign up for if you have any interest in what I'm discussing. But you can also sign up to his mailing list and check out his website and also buy his wares, some of which are quite incredible and powerful. But in the Bacatrix, it says that talisman means to break and to violate and to damage. And it explains that the meaning of this is that it's a way of taking a material object and reforming it, giving it a rebirth so that spiritual power can be funneled into it and invested into it. Talismans are alive. The material body of a talisman, whether it is a gemstone or a metallic object or a liquid or any number of a variety of other substances, is like the body. And the energy which is invested within it is like a spirit. It is a direct analog to a human being because we are spirit nested in matter. And when used, talismans can provide unbelievable power and amazing effects. And it is distinctive from practically every form of magic you're likely to have encountered for a variety of reasons. And one of which is that it is actually a very early tradition, and a lot of this material was lost. And over the centuries, particularly in the Victorian era, people tried to rebuild what had been lost and came up with completely different material. So that most of the magic you will encounter today is a descendant of Eliphas Levi and the Victorian tradition, which focuses on magic as a combination of willpower and imagination. And this has nothing at all to do with traditional astrological magic. Talismans have the following properties as I have discovered, and other researchers such as John Michael Greer, Christopher Warnock, and Robert Zoller and Robert Hand have discovered. They are durable. They don't burn out. Once you charge them once, they last absolutely forever. Some last longer than others in a certain sense. Planetary talismans will last a lifetime. Stellar talismans, which is what we'll be focusing on today, last a few thousand years at the very least. There's an indication in the Bacatrix that if you are trying to build a house and bring good to it, you create a planetary talisman. But if you were founding a city and you want to last a thousand years, you use a fixed star talisman. Again, it requires no visualization. And this is a part of the astrological magical tradition, which is a bit of a shocker. Because we, in our modern interpretation of magic, believe the magic comes with, from within us. Traditional magic, astrological magic, from this sequence of the Hermetic tradition, believed that magic came from outside. It came from the stars, it came from the heavens, and it was invested in material objects. If you were to watch a 19th century play, and you were to see a magician come on stage in magician garb, you would notice some interesting things about him that you'd be very familiar with, and some things you wouldn't. You may or may not have seen the wizard with a conical hat, but usually he would be wearing some kind of weird exotic hat. He would often have turned up slippers with pointed ends. He would invariably, however, be wearing long garments with astrological symbols emblazoned on it, and he'd be wearing these big honking rings, very glittery and flashy, that you could see even in the back row. And these are hints towards how people understood the magical tradition up until only a few decades ago, because most people in America had a classical education. They were reading Herodotus and Plato, which are full of magical references, and they deal with the notion of magical rings and its connection with astrology. And the turned up slippers, sort of looking from the Arabian Nights, it's a nod to the fact that the idea of magic coming into our culture came from the Far East in Persia. Now, I wanted to explain a little bit about how the astrological magicians look at the universe. This is heavily influenced by Neoplatonism, which is a bit of a misnomer because this is probably, as they originally claimed, the secret teachings of Plato, who was, in addition to being a philosopher, was a great mystic. And also this may have been a significant part of the secret teachings of Pythagoras. It believed that the Earth was at the center of a series of nested spheres, each of which ring outward, and at the final outer perimeter was the One, the unity of the universe, which is indivisible. It was an analogous to God, but it had no personality. It was ultimate unity, and it is the ultimate attainment level of what most mystics would consider Nirvana, basically ultimate unity of being. And in this hierarchy, it would break down to archetypes at the ultimate level, the tropical zodiac, and then the sphere of the fixed stars within it, and then the seven traditional planets, Saturn on the outer periphery, Jupiter, Mars, the Sun, Venus, Mercury, and the Moon. And we are living in what is called the sublunar sphere, which has a predominant influence by the Moon in our physical universe. The only place in the entirety of the universe where things can truly change. In this view of the universe, we are in the crucible of transformation for spiritual beings, which begin at the One, break off from the One, descend into the universe and adopt seven garments of light from each of the traditional planets, which give us destiny, give us our personality, and give us our health. And that is why astrology is supposed to work, because our spirit bodies are compositions of seven of these elements, each of which have been altered by the timing of the planet's movements at the time of our first breath. One of the interesting things about talismans is they deal with ultimate outcomes, which are distinct from other magical practices, in my opinion. I'm sure many of you have had experiences, if you've been doing a hardcore practical magic, where you ask for something and then it slipped between your fingers, or you had a monkey's paw effect. You ask for love and you get what you asked for, but it's not quite what you hoped, or it begins to dissipate and dissolve. You ask for money, and the money goes away pretty quickly. You end up exactly where you started, or worse. Astrological magic deals with the factors of fate and destiny, and because the planets themselves are very durable and have the symbolism of eternity, the power that these talismans, which are invested with astrological power, radiate, tend to be exceptionally durable. And they tend to deal with ultimate outcomes, so that if you are working with a talisman, it may take a few months to a year for you to actually develop an attunement and relationship with it, but it will transform your life forever. And that is very different from a mojo bag, which will burn out, or other objects of power, or even rituals and pacts that you have with particular spiritual entities. It also has huge legendary power, and that's what I was talking about with regards to the lightning bolts. One of the things that you will encounter when you get invested in modern magic, Victorian magic as I call it, whether it's by way of the Golden Dawn, or Aleister Crowley, or various forms of Wicca, is that they are kind of agnostic about whether the legendary feats of magic ever happened. Flying carpets, mirrors of infallible scrying, the transformation of lead into gold, because basically nobody since the Victorian era has been able to do any of that. And because magic in the modern era tends to be a little bit skeptical and cautious, it has often promoted the idea that many of these things were metaphors or distortions of original practice. That isn't the case at all in this astrological magical tradition. They not only say that the more radical effects of magic were possible, can be done, they give you direct instructions on how to do them. But they are complicated enough that, well, it will take years for us to discover exactly how true that is. This is a true rediscovery of a tradition. But the tradition is really sturdy. It existed in various forms from its export from Persia all the way into the Mediterranean basin, and it really continued up until about 1700 when astrology fell out of favor, largely due to fights between the Catholics and Protestants and issues about predestination. It's both mystical and practical. Though I tend to focus upon the practical end of magic, there is no doubt that the process of working with magical talismans, which is much more involved than you may think, is an initiation. It is a series of ordeals. Because in the process of working within this tradition, you have to learn a great deal of astrology. You have to wake up at 3 a.m. sometimes to inscribe sigils on a variety of objects, sometimes very precious, and investing of money can be seen as a sort of an initiation. And then you have to learn how to use them by petitioning various powers and learning how to channel that power outward. And when you do that, you connect to a hierarchy of being, which stems from the ultimate one at the pinnacle of reality down to physical humanity, spirits, and elementals. And if you have that great relationship, which you can develop over time, you have pretty much absolute, in theory, absolute power over that hierarchy of being. So for example, if you developed a great attunement and relationship with Venus, you would have power over love, both for yourself and for others, and you would have influence or connection, even a psychic connection, to all other people who are in a venereal state, whether it's sexual, romantic, or artistic. And the ultimate notion is that if you attain ascendancy through these hierarchies, you will become an enlightened being. You will, in a Judeo-Christian sense, become archangelic. In a pagan and polytheistic sense, become one with the diamonds. And upon death, you will ascend the spirit hierarchies and join with those spirits that you have been developing a relationship with. This is a way to not attain heaven, but attain greater hierarchy in the afterworld as well. Another thing about astrological talismans is that they shed no aura that is detectable outside of the system. So if you are inclined to go covert, whether it's among other magicians or throughout your life, no one will be able to detect that these objects have mystical power. When I first started exploring this system and began to wear these pendants, I felt like I might have been ripped off because it wasn't emanating any noticeable power. And then after about 6 months, things started to fall into place. I started becoming attuned to the frequency of the energies of the talismans. And after about a year of this initiatory process, I started to be able to do some really remarkable stuff. And I'll talk about that later if I have time. It's also intellectually challenging. This is arguably the most complicated magical system that has ever been developed in all of history. On the astrological level, it took me 10 years to really develop mastery in it, but that's just the techniques and the scholium of traditional astrology, which is very different from modern astrology. On my desk, I have the two books of astronomy, Liber Astronomiae by Guido Bonatti, which was the textbook of astrology in the medieval era. And it's this friggin' thick. And if you were going to be practicing magic or any form of traditional astrology, you had to know that both backwards and forwards. It is hard work. Fortunately, there are people out there who, for a prize, will teach you how to do astrological elections, and I'll explain that in a few minutes, or will teach you how to do the full gamut of astrological magic. Trying to get through these books on your own will drive you fucking mad. But another thing that you can do is you can pair yourself up with a person who knows the astrology, and you can do the magical end of it. So for example, Chris Warnock on his mailing list will occasionally give an appropriate time to create a talisman and give instructions on how to do it. And then all you have to do is get the materials together, and you can have your ring or your pendant at the end of the process and begin working with those energies. And that's really a good way to start the process of exploring this. Because, frankly, getting heavily invested in astrological calculations is a lot of time unless you really know that this is the system for you. And it may not be. This is the most elite of elite high magics in all of Western tradition, in all of history, as far as we can tell. I hear people telling me that the Chinese forms of magic are as complicated as this, but I don't know it as well. But I will say, this is mind-blowing shit. This is the super physics, the rocket science of the medieval era. And the magic that it can perform, in theory, can do anything you can imagine and practically anything you can't imagine. Now, what you have before you, hopefully, is what's called the Liber Hermetis. There are actually many different Liber Hermetises in this tradition. Attributing things to Hermes Trismegistus was as common as attributing things to the 6th, 7th, 10th, and 47,000th books of Moses. It was a way to prevent the author from getting burned at the stake and also propping up its authority. But this is a very unusual grimoire because it's very short, it's focused upon 15 particular fixed stars. And when I'm talking about fixed stars, I'm talking about the stars we see in the sky which don't move around. Everything from Betelgeuse to Aldebaran to Vega. I'm sure you've heard about them, especially if you watch a lot of sci-fi. That's where people travel to and aliens come from. But in the astrological magical tradition, these were the sources of light, the doorways to a kingdom, a feudal hierarchy of powerful spirit beings that at particular times and places could have absolute dominance over reality. Now the planets we can sort of relate to because we understand some of the symbolism of them because they have names appropriate to the Roman gods. Mars is aggression, the Sun is rulership, light and life, Venus is love, Saturn is age, Jupiter is sometimes wealth and piety. And Mercury, of course, is to a certain degree magic and definitely knowledge and craftsmanship. These are things we can relate to. But the fixed stars have a slightly more subtle dominance over reality, and they control things that are sometimes hard to get into the headspace regarding. The entities that we can connect with in the planetary hierarchies are beings we can relate to within their field of influence. If we are in a combat situation, we will want to relate to Mars, and Mars can understand us, and the spirits associated with Mars can understand us when we are in an aggressive mode. If we basically ask Mars for help with love, he's not going to do so well. nor are his spirits or powers. But the fixed stars are extremely narrow and specific and very alien in nature, but also because they are of a higher order of reality than the planets, they have dominance over all the planets. They have superior power to the planets. They are of a higher hierarchy. And though it's sometimes harder to get the talismans working for the fixed stars, when you do so, the power is phenomenal. Now, another thing that is interesting about these particular fixed stars, and there are 15 in number, is that they were called the Behenian stars. They were, first of all, the stars of greatest magnitude. They're the brightest ones in the heavens. But Behen in Arabic is a particular type of root. And the meaning of this is these were actually the root stars. What are the root stars? Well, I told you about the seven garments of light that people attain as they descend into reality and attain corporeal form. Well, the planets get that power from somewhere else. They get it from the Behenian stars. They are the root of the power of the planets. So that just as we get our personality attributes, our emotions, our personality, our constitution from the planets themselves are refractors and reflectors of the Behenian powers. And because they are the ultimate source of these energies, if, for example, we have messed up astrological charts like I do, we can tap into these fixed stars to act as band-aids. Now, one of the proper usages for planetary talismans are to heal damage which occurred in our astrological chart, our natal chart at birth. So for example, my Venus is in a really bad place. I'm very unlucky in love. Aww. One way to approach that is by getting a Venus talisman, which will basically seal that rift. And it may not bring me up to the level of being Casanova, but it'll at least allow me to get along and have a happy love life. But sometimes that's not even enough. The fixed stars allow miraculous and greater feats of power and greater revisions to your energetic framework. Now, some of the fixed stars we know are associated with particular planets. We don't know all of that. We've been trying to connect it together, we who are researching this material now. But let me give you an example that's concrete. One of my favorite fixed star talismans in the form of a ring is Antares. And if you see it on the paper there, it basically is the stone is sardonyx, which is a red and white striped onyx. It's also known as Cor Scorpionis. It is the heart of the constellation Scorpio. And this is one of my favorite ones to begin because it will introduce you why I find this grimoire so fascinating. The reason why it's called Antares is that it's similar to Aries. It has energies extremely similar to Mars. So that if you have, in a traditional astrological framework, a bad position of Mars in your natal chart, you can wear this ring, or ring like it, and it will basically seal that rift for good. But it has other properties which are quite interesting. This is a ring which gives you not only wisdom, but the appearance of wisdom. And this, I feel, is the key to understanding the Liber Hermetis particularly. Because I believe this grimoire, distinctive from all the other grimoires of this particular magical tradition, was not designed for commercial usage. Most of the talismanic tradition was an attempt to make a buck. You would make magical rings and pendants, and you would sell them to princes and dukes, and occasionally poor people, who, you know, cheap and dirty versions of the same. But I believe that this particular grimoire was an attempt to create a magical toolkit by magicians for magicians. And the reason why I believe this is that there's a huge emphasis in this grimoire on being liked, having favor, high honors, the increase of wealth, which is always good, and looking smart, The idea is that this set of 15 rings is sort of an array of magical mind control in a passive sense to make people like you and to bring you repeat customers. It gives you money and makes customers like you, and it makes you seem really smart. And I think that is why the Liber Hermetis is so essential and so important if you want to attain the wizarding business. And one of the things that I've discovered in the history of astrological magic is that wizards were not just fictional characters. They were traveling astrologers and merchants who would basically go from kingdom to kingdom and would heal the sick, would find lost objects, much like the later cunning men, and they would perform various odds and ends of magical material until basically they had exhausted the king's trove and then move on to the next area. And I believe that they would use these magical rings as a way of plying their trade and optimizing their profits and not getting people too resentful of them or getting burned at the stake. Now, one of the things that is interesting about this notion of magic embodied in physical objects, and it's linked to astrological magic, is that I believe that what it is trying to convey to people is that preparation is wisdom. Now, one of the problems with modern magic is that if you're in a crisis, you may not be in the proper frame of mind to react to it magically. If you're on fire, it's hard to cast a water spell to put it out. But if you are creating magical talismans, they will be operating in a passive way perpetually. And a part of the process of working as an astrological magician is waiting for appropriate timing to create these objects in preparation for when you will need them in the future. So that when I discover an optimal time to create a talisman, I will engrave it or cast it in metal or do it in any variety of other ways, even if I have no imaginable need for that, because those needs will come inevitably in the process of life. That is wisdom. And wisdom is where the word wizard comes from. Just like a drunkard is someone who is always drunk, a wizard is someone who is wise. And even though historically, the term wisdom has often been a metaphor for magic, the ultimate notion is that a magician is someone who is knowledgeable of both exoteric and esoteric matters and a master of preparedness, frankly. Now, talismans are objects invested with the spirits of the stars. And they come in many different forms. I've told you about the rings, and some people would not necessarily consider talismans rings because we have a cultural notion of what talismans are at this point after hundreds of years of the use of that term. But talismans are just an indication of the technique of how to empower the object so that you can have a glass of water, which is a talisman. And I'll tell you how to do that in a moment. Pendants, like these under my shirt, or this one on top of my shirt, are talismans. You may have heard the word jinx before. Jinxes actually are talismans, and they're not negative at all. The ancient Persians would take these globes of semi-precious spheres, agate, for example, or solid gold, and they would invest them with power, with sigils that they would engrave upon at propitious astrological times. And then they would spin these spheres as fast as they could, and while the spheres were spinning, it would mimic the movements of the heavens and radiate power outward. You may have also heard of defixiones, or catadesmoi. And these were lead sheets that people would use for curses and so forth. They would basically be written upon, curled up, and buried at particular points underneath a building or in a graveyard. And one of the things that we are discovering now is there's a heavy astrological element in the defixiones as well. Now, one of the reasons why particular materials are used in talismans is that the Zoroastrians, in general, were light worshippers. And the Zervanites liked pendants and shiny things. they created what I call the Zervanite thesis, that light equals spirit equals power equals good equals time. And they assumed, and I believe they may have been correct, otherwise I wouldn't be doing all this, that objects that have unusual properties with physical light may attain unusual properties with astral light, soul stuff, the pure liquid element of time. They can store it and radiate it and channel it. That is why water, in some traditions, was able to attain the power of the moon. You may have, this is actually appears in some modern Wiccan rituals where you hold a silver bowl up to the moon and you catch the moonlight and then you imbibe the water. This is a liquid talisman because the surface of the water is reflective. Another material which is often used in astrological talismans is wax, because in the ancient world there were very few objects which would naturally reflect an image. Of course, there was gold and silver, and there were semi-precious stones, but a lump of wax, if properly polished, will also reflect an image, and they felt that this was a cheap and dirty way to create a cookie talisman. Now, some of this will come together for you when I say the following thing. Traditional astrology is a symmetrical system. What is a symmetrical system? Well, if you are familiar with the concept of tarot magic, you have encountered a symmetrical system. You can use tarot cards to predict the future, but you can use tarot magic to cause the future. That is a symmetrical system. And once upon a time, all divinatory systems were symmetrical systems. If you work with the runes to predict the future, you can also use runecraft to create the future and use them to cause reality. And that is the concept behind traditional astrological talismans. You are using the invested power of these objects to rewrite reality. Now, traditional astrology followed four different categories, of which we're only going to deal with the fourth. The first is, the first is hoary astrology, which basically uses astrology like a tarot reading. It will tell you what you need to know. Does she love me? What will happen tomorrow? What's the best possible choice? The second category was natal astrology. That's what most people know. That's about your birth, your destiny, your personality, and so forth. The third category is mundane astrology, and that's like Nostradamus. It predicts big things, cultures, nations, the rise and fall of the world. But the fourth category is what we're dealing with here, and it's called electional astrology. It's the picking of lucky times to commence endeavors. Just like a person's birth will somehow be invested with the seven garments of energy and give them a trajectory in life, it's not just people, it's events, it's objects. So that traditional astrologers and traditional astrological magicians made a whole lot of money doing marriage elections, where if you wanted to increase the chances of a happy marriage, you would pick a lucky time, and there would be elaborate instructions on how to achieve this. There would be optimal times, electional times, and election means to choose, to begin a war, to start a book, to begin a journey, and before I started traveling out here to these conventions, you can bet I did a travel election. Which has been very lucky for me, I think. But there was a subcategory of electional astrology, which is talismanic elections. And this was an attempt to figure out a way of taking those temporary elections, or, well, temporary is not the right word. Let me explain to you the problem with elections. If you are waiting for the perfect time for something to begin, you could be waiting forever. If you want the ultimate marriage election, it might happen 70 years after you're dead. That's no good to anybody. But one of the interesting things you can do is you can basically create a battery, a storage place for these energies, so that when you need them later on, you don't need the election, you just put on the ring. Or you put on the pendant, or you command the spirits associated with it. It's a way of getting beyond that little problem. And this is sort of what astrological magicians did throughout history. They would have a little bit of a, not really a scam going, but it sometimes feels like one. They would say, I looked at your chart and you're going to die of decapitation on this year. And they were very fatalistic back then, so they didn't pull any punches. Your chart says, you're an asshole. You're doomed, you are stuck in this particular trajectory of fate. And the guy would get all depressed, or the woman, and then said, wait, I think I may have a solution for you. I have this talisman made of gold, or diamond, or some other substance, and I'll sell you this, and this will solve your problem. And that might be considered a scam, except for the fact that it worked. A lot of people have problems with the notion of astrology as predestination, fatalism. Astrological magic is the loophole. It is the way to get past fatalism. It is a way of saying, yes, fate exists, and we can kick it in the knees. We can get beyond it. And that was the intention of the Zoroastrians. They felt they were trapped in a rather drab physical reality, and they wanted to reach up out into higher realms, even before their deaths, and circumvent fate and evolve, which is, in a spiritual sense, not our natural trajectory. Now, I'm not sure if you've ever heard of geomancy, but I'm not talking about feng shui. But there's also a notion of a lost art, a semi-lost art of geomancy in the Western tradition, and it is not only a symmetrical system of divination and magic, but it is also very heavily astrological. And there's a book by John Michael Greer, which I highly recommend, which deals with geomancy, and it is actually a very good introductory point into the exploration of traditional astrology. Geomancy uses 16 figures of dots, odds and evens, which allows you to predict the future. And it's a little bit like I Ching, or I Ching, however you pronounce that, and a little bit like runic divination, because the 16 figures have lots of associations that are visual. Now, I'm sure at least some of you have had the guilty pleasure of reading the Harry Potter series. Well, some of the character names come from geomancy. Albus, Rubius, these are geomantical figures. And the characters that appear in the stories are extrapolations of these symbolic 16 figures. Now, the way you create a astrological ring, for example, is that you basically take a gemstone, you can buy it on eBay like I do, and you wait until the fixed star, in this instance, is ascending in conjunction with the moon, and that's a bit of a technical term. The moon is getting closer to that fixed point in the heavens. And when I say rising, I say it's coming over the eastern horizon, like the rising of the sun. And you engrave a particular sigil, which appears in the grimoire that you see there, and you put beneath it a particular herb, and you pray, and you suffumigate. And suffumigation is basically the source of the idea of burning incense. And the idea of suffumigation is that you're creating a kind of fluidic, what's the right word for it? A womb, an energetic womb for the gestation and the permeability. It basically is allowing the astral rays to connect with the gemstone. And when you are carving the sigil, it is the equivalent of what I call a reverse cesarean section. You're cutting into it so that the spirit will get into the body of the ring and investing it with life and power.
What tool do you use to carve?
Diamond tip stylus. $30. Works about 30 times before the tip gets blunt, but you know, considering the other costs, it's quite affordable. Another thing that you can do is you can create negative molds for wax talismans, or buy brass seals on stationary sites and create wax talismans that way. I don't want to open this up, but these are wax talismans here that I basically used using stationary images of a rabbit for Venus, a bird for Spica, the image of the moon on a silver one, and they radiate power. This is also a good, cheap way to carry them in your pocket and go through airport security without all the noises blinking off. But I find most effective are these rings. Here are a few of them. This is a chalcedony by Deneb Aljady. You'll see that towards the end there, and this is for wealth and the protection of the home. And this quartz crystal ring is the ring of the Pleiades. Now, one of the things that you'll see in there is that the ring of the Pleiades requires quicksilver being put underneath the ring. I don't do that because I don't want to die. Substitutions are often very important because some of the ingredients that you'll see in this grimoire are toxic, but I'm including them there strictly for historical purposes. And you can also use homeopathic methods to retain the energy to eliminate all the chemical substances which could perhaps cause you misery.
What would you use for the quicksilver?
I used white poppy seeds because it's lunar.
White poppy seeds.
And that's one of the best rings of all because this is really kind of the best of the bunch in the sense of the wizardly trade. It allows you to conjure spirits, call the winds, and discover lost things. And I use this ring in combination with what I call a petition. I'll get to that in a minute. To blow storms away from the path of the airplanes that I'm flying on. And through rings like this, I've been able to not only avoid a substantial amount of travel delays, but also provide it for friends of mine. I basically put on the ring, and when Zero Gemini is rising on the horizon, I pray to the angel of the Pleiades, please blow all the storms away from the path of my friends so they can arrive at convocation on time. And it works perfectly. It's amazing stuff. Now, a part of understanding traditional astrology is what I call the solar metaphor. When the sun comes rising over the eastern horizon, the whole world is transformed. It is quiet and dark, and then the dawn appears, everything becomes beautiful and enchanted, dew appears in all the flowers, the cock crows, and then things begin to get warmer. That's because the eastern horizon, the ascendant, is the key point of liminality in traditional astrology. Because the ancients came to believe that if the sun could perform all these transformations to the physical world, other stellar bodies would also have dominion over that liminal point. So that when Venus is coming over the ascendant, Venus is at a point of particular influence over reality. And in the case of the fixed stars, when, say, Aldebaran is rising over the horizon, it is propitious to wealth and fame. There's also the notion of culmination. And that is when the star or planet is immediately overhead, like the sun at noon, which is when the sun casts the least amount of shadows and it's at its warmest. And that is also a point of particular power. Over time, this developed and broke down into 12 divisions, which we call the mundane house system. And if you are familiar at all with astrology, you've heard, you know, the 12th house, the 7th house. This originally started as an elaboration of the notion of liminality at the point of ascendancy and the midheaven. Ascending, culminating, rising, you know what I mean at this point. I'm getting the terms all mixed up. I hope. Now, I told you that in these various layers of reality, we are the closest to the moon. We are in the sublunar realm. Immediately above us, in this sort of nested Russian doll hierarchy of reality, is the moon. And one of the key elements in electional astrology is that no matter what you're doing, you're always paying attention to what the moon is doing. And that is why, other than the rising of the fixed star, the moon must be coming closer to it, applying to it, as they say. And what that is an indication of the increasing power of the fixed star and its ability to transmit its alteration of reality into the physical realm. The moon is the womb of reality. And if you want things to manifest materially, you have to pay attention to it, and that is a major factor in every form of electional astrology, including talismanic elections. Well, the way you learn to figure some of this out is by buying an astrology program or going to astro.com or reading a few articles in basic astrology, because even if you're dealing with modern astrology, basic concepts like the ascendant and the midheaven are universal. They appear in every form of astrological systems. basic books on astrology will be enough to get you into an understanding of how the heavens work. And looking at an astrological chart, whether you're using something dirt cheap or non-expensive at all, like astro.com, it's free, or something expensive and specialized, like what I use, Solar Fire, which costs $700. Both are basically ideal for something as specific as the fixed star elections, because these are actually the simplest forms of talismanic elections imaginable, because they're dealing with only two factors: what is rising or culminating, and whether the moon is getting closer to it or not. Everything else you can ignore.
How close do you want the moon applying? Does it need to be in the same sign? Do you just pick a day when it is? I mean, every 28 days the moon is going to get close to that.
Right.
But you have to pick the day. I mean, like if it's closer the following day when it's starting the separation portion of that,
if
you want it applying.
You need it to be applying. Separation is an indication of the power diminishing eternally.
Okay.
Applying is an indication of the power growing eternally.
Right.
As for how soon can you do it, the truth is the tighter the moon's application to the fixed star is, the stronger the power.
Better. So you wait for a month when they're going to be pretty close together.
You basically get about one good fixed star election per ring once every 2 years on average. And you also, because you're noticing the power of the moon, some of them work better for waxing and some work better for waning. So if you want wealth, you want a waxing moon. And if it's to banish demons, you probably want a waning moon. But most of them, however, are sort of neutral. And it doesn't really make a difference whether the moon is waxing or waning. If you're getting rather advanced in astrology, you may want to avoid hard aspects to other planets and maybe looking towards soft aspects to planets as much as possible, because that will increase and decrease power accordingly. But that's not what most of you need to know.
When you were saying about when you're inscribing and doing a prayer to an angel-elect deities, is that attributing a deity to each of these different stars, or to a specific planet around each of these stars? To the extent that you have multiple deities that are at extended distance that we're calling upon for that power?
The actual nature of the astrological entities and the hierarchies involved, and I was going to get to this in a minute, are not really deities. They fit into the Neoplatonic notion of the hierarchy of reality. They're beneath the gods, but they are also exceptionally powerful. They are the princes and princesses of the universe. They,
so in a classical sense, they're technically demons, in the sense that they are spiritual beings.
In a classical sense, late classical sense, they would be intelligences. Basically, because it's a full hierarchy. Let's say, I keep using the venereal hierarchy because everybody wants a bit of love. The ultimate intelligentsary is Hagiel, which you probably may have seen in certain grimoires like Francis Barrett's The Magus and Cornelius Agrippa. And beneath that would be a feudal hierarchy of spirits which serve them like a queen. And then beneath them, subsidiary spirits which would be considered daimons. And then finally, there would be manifestations of Venus in our physical world, such as people who are in love, music. And on a base level, there would be elementals, which have a venereal quality. So this is a full hierarchy, a chain of being, which stretches from the most absolute abstract version of venereal energy all the way down to things which you can hold in your hand.
Hmm. Do you find that this hierarchy is localized only, or is it subject to your position in the universe? For an example, if you lived at one of those stars, would the Earth become one of that hierarchy that you would actually inscribe onto possibly a talisman?
Well, one of the things that magic from 200 BC doesn't deal with is traveling to outer space. So I really don't know.
I'm thinking from an engineering point of view.
I got you. But I think that